Hello, my name is Nancy.
Hello, my name is Rowan. Welcome to our show, Hands-On Health. This is a program established by Deaf and Hard of Hearing Services for the purpose of discussing health issues with our deaf community so that we can feel empowered to make good decisions for our health.
So today, we're going to discuss COVID-19, and we have a special guest. Her name is Karla Black. Karla is from Kent County Health Department, and she's going to tell us more about COVID. Welcome, Karla. And thank you for coming. Could you share a little bit about your background and your role in the Kent County Health Department?
Thanks for having me. So what I do at the Kent County Health Department is I'm the Emergency Preparedness Coordinator. So my job there is to write plans and prepare people for disasters such as COVID-19. The thing is that before my role at the Kent County Health Department, I used to be a scientist. I actually used to work on different types of viruses. And so talking about viruses such as COVID-19 is pretty in my arena.
Interesting. So COVID-19, explain to us what it is and how it got its name, COVID-19.
So I brought a friend today. This is my virus, COVID-19. But actually, a lot of people call it COVID-19, but that's the name of the disease, not the virus itself. So the virus itself's name is SARS-CoV-2, but a lot of people just say COVID-19 because it's a lot easier to say. So the disease itself is called COVID-19, and it's a conglomeration of all the different pieces of the name. So for COVID, CO is for coronavirus, which is the type of virus it is because it looks like it has a crown on. And then the VI of corona, of COVID is virus. And then the D is disease. But the thing that tends to confuse people a little bit about COVID-19 is the 19. 19 is only because it was discovered in 2019, not because there was 18 other viruses like that beforehand. It's just the year that it was discovered.
So how, as far as how do we contract COVID-19 and it becomes a disease, how does that come about?
So when somebody has COVID-19, they basically either cough, sneeze, talk, sing, and little droplets come out that have virus particles in it. So our friend COVID here. And so when people inhale those or touch them on a surface and then touch their eyes or their face or their mouth, that's how they get COVID. And so we really want to make sure that people don't really touch their faces, or, you know, if people are sick, they stay away from others.
So I'm just curious, if you have a group of vaccinated people or unvaccinated people, and those who are unvaccinated or even with a vaccination, how do you stay protected? Hand washing, social distancing, what is the best way to stay protected?
I think you've already mentioned a lot of the really big ones we would tell you to do. First of all, even if it's not related to COVID, wash your hands. Wash your hands helps you make sure that you don't get sick from any of the communicable diseases, the flu, colds, other things. So we really do want people to wash their hands. But then also, we do want people to get vaccinated. People that are vaccinated tend not to get sick with COVID-19, but they also don't end up in the hospital, and they are even less likely to die with COVID-19. And with COVID-19, we're not sure who will have a bad outcome. And so we really just want everyone to take protective measures. So washing hands, get your vaccines. If you're ill, make sure you stay away from others. Even if you think, oh, it's just allergies. If you've never had allergies before, we want to make sure that you go get tested to find out if you have COVID-19 or not, because knowing is the best knowledge at that point. But masking can be important too. If you're not vaccinated, especially, you know, you don't know if you're carrying the disease, but also that mask will give you some level of protection against the virus itself too. And so we want to make sure that people are using measures also, such as social distancing. So again, if you're not vaccinated, try to stay kind of apart from each other, 3 to 6 feet at least. But if you're vaccinated, you can actually be closer together, because at least if you've been vaccinated, you're less likely to be carrying the disease.
So we're curious about the CDC and all of their recommendations, and we noticed that they do change quite often. Why is that?
So the CDC is a body of scientists, actually, and so they're always learning new things. We're always doing testing new options. They're always learning more and more about the virus itself. And so science takes time. And because science takes time, we're learning new things every day. And so that's why they change the recommendations, because they find out something new. And so they want to make sure that the guidance is in relation to the science that they know. And so as we keep learning more and more things, it's expected that we're going to change the guidance, because we've learned something new that tells us, hey, this is better for us.
In looking at a family, say you have a family of five and one individual in the family has COVID, whereas the others don't. So is it safe to stay in the home or to go out during that time?
So when somebody is ill, we want them to stay home, even if it's not COVID. We want people who are sick to stay home and stay away from other people. But we know that with COVID in a household, that's where a lot of the spread actually happens. So if a parent is sick, more likely their child is going to get sick. But you can stop that from happening by trying to keep somebody in a specific place, and we call that isolation. So if they're sick, we want them to be isolated. But if for the rest of the family, we don't want them going out into public either, and because we call that quarantine. And so we want them to stay home and not really interact with people, because we know that the virus can actually be spread from person to person without somebody actually having symptoms yet. So if, let's say, my child had COVID and I didn't know it quite yet, and I was around them, hugging them, kissing them, more than likely I'm probably going to get COVID. But I might not be symptomatic yet. And so if I were to go to work or something like that, I could be already starting to have virus coming out of me while I'm talking. And so we wouldn't want people to be around others and potentially spreading it when they don't know what they have.
My question is related to that. It just seems like there's a little bit of confusion. You use that word isolated and quarantined. So can you expand on each of those and what they actually mean? What does isolation mean, and what does quarantine mean?
Yeah, in the media, they mix this up a lot. And so there is a lot of confusion as to what quarantine is, what isolation is, and they are two totally different things. With isolation, that is somebody who is actually sick. So you know that they have COVID-19, and we want to separate them from other people that aren't sick. With quarantine, they've been exposed to somebody who has had has COVID-19 currently, but they're not sick yet. It's just kind of a waiting period to see if they do get sick. So some people do get sick, some people don't. But this is the quarantine is the time that we're waiting to see if they actually do get the disease. So they're totally different.
So in using masks, I know it's very important, and that's to prevent the spread of the virus. And if both individuals facing each other have the mask, that's again very important. But what are we talking about as far as quality of masks? What kind of masks should we be looking for?
So there are all sorts of styles of masks out right now. Probably the one with the lowest amount of protection but still does absolutely help are cloth masks. So the cloth masks are usually we want at least 2 to 3 layers to have some distance and so that less particles will get through. But those are probably what I would call the lowest quality, but they absolutely do help and do work. Then kind of the next step up are surgical masks. Those are the ones that you see that are kind of like a paper mask that the doctors wear during surgeries, things like that. You can buy these at stores currently. Those help too, and they usually have some sort of thing on the nose so that it can form better to your nose, because that's really helpful too, because you want your mask to fit tightly on your face. Then the next level up, I'll say, is what we call a KN95. Those do fit pretty tightly on your face, and they usually do have that nose bridge area to kind of keep it on your face, and they're a little bit thicker than a surgical mask. And so those are really helpful too. The next one up, and which is the highest level, would be an N95. For the general public, we would not necessarily recommend an N95 because people can have a really hard time breathing with those. They're actually a respirator, and so a lot of times, like, I have an N95 for my work, but I don't wear it out in public because I actually have to go through a test to make sure I can wear it and it doesn't harm my health. So we don't want people to just wear an N95 just because it can be harder to breathe, and that's not what you necessarily need in this case.
Interesting. So when should we be using masks? What kind of situations should we be wearing masks?
So right now the CDC has recommended that in places that have higher levels of transmission, that people vaccinated or unvaccinated, both of them should be wearing a mask. Currently Kent County is not there, but probably in the next week or so, we will probably be at the level that CDC recommends that everyone, regardless if they're vaccinated or not, wears a mask. The other times that you might consider wearing a mask is if you're outdoors at a large event where there's a lot of people right on top of one another, because we've seen that with COVID, being outdoors, it doesn't spread as easily. But if you're at a large festival, a large concert where everyone's packed so tightly together, you might want to consider wearing a mask in that case, just so that potentially you have less of a chance to get COVID if somebody is infectious. Because we've already seen a number of events this summer, outdoors even, that people have been there during their infectious time and they could spread it.
So when you're outside at an event and it's a large event that's packed versus smaller events, would you still advise wearing masks at both?
If they're both outdoors, if you're able to keep a pretty good distance from others, I would say you don't necessarily have to wear a mask. I mean, it's more about your comfort at that time. If you feel that you would feel more comfortable wearing your mask, even though people are spread out, absolutely feel free to wear your mask. If you don't, you know, that's fine too. But those times that you're outdoors or indoors at any event, you know, you should really consider wearing your mask, especially if there's a lot of people around you that you can't have space. You're welcome.
Thank you. So there has been a lot of talk about this variant called Delta. And with that variant, should our deaf community be concerned about that? And how does that relate to COVID? Explain more about the Delta variant, please.
So we've heard a lot about the Delta variant and other variants in the news. And so I think a lot of people are kind of confused and they think it's a whole new virus or something like that. So I'm gonna bring our friend COVID back out again. So if this is what we call normal coronavirus, COVID-19, basically what happens, there's just a couple mutations that happen in these spike proteins. These are our friend's spike. And so if these are mutations, basically it just changes a little bit. What the spikes look like. So all the different spikes would have these mutations in them. And so it allows it, if this is your cell, to bind better with your cells. And so that's why it could potentially be more transmissible, because it can attach to your cells better, or it finds other ways to make it easier to spread the disease. So it still looks the same for the most part, but there's just little changes on these little spike proteins that make it a variant. And so the Delta variant we've heard so far is that there's 1,000 times more virus particles in your nose and in your throat. And so that means that there's a lot more virus coming out as people talk, as they sneeze, and so it makes it easily more transmissible to other people. So it is something that is very concerning, especially with people that are unvaccinated. I mean, because we are seeing breakthrough cases on people that are vaccinated, but for those that are not, they have a much higher chance that they're going to get sick because they have no protection.
So we've already talked about how we have the Delta variant, and we have other variants as well. How do those come about?
So viruses are basically like little machines. All they do is try and make more and more and more of themselves. And they don't have really good ways of spot checking themselves. So sometimes they make mistakes. And those mistakes we call mutants or mutations. And so as they make more and more mistakes, sometimes it makes them better or sometimes it makes them worse, depending on how it goes. So if you keep on making little tiny mistakes, sometimes that might make it easier for the virus to spread from one person to another. Or maybe it might make the virus itself fall apart. Well, that's not a helpful mutation, but the ones that stick around, the ones that can make it spread easier, that's how we keep on getting those variants. And so the more and more that the virus spreads in the community, the more chances there are for a variant to come about, because they keep on making these little mistakes. So remember, we had our little dots on here. You can get more and more of those dots on in your virus. And so that's where those variants keep coming.
Thank you. That's very interesting.
Also for variants, how do we prevent the coronavirus or COVID-19 from developing more variants? Can we prevent that?
Well, we can try. And the way that we try to do that, people get vaccinated, that people stay home when they're sick, people wash their hands, they wear their masks when they're out around a lot of people. And so those are ways that we try to stop people from getting COVID-19, because the more people get it, the more likely we're going to see more variants, ones that potentially could be worse than Delta.
So where can I go to get reliable current information about the COVID pandemic?
So what I really recommend is that you visit your local health department's website. So for us here in Kent County, that would be the Kent County Health Department. But I know that Deaf and Hard of Hearing Services covers a lot of different places that have different health departments. So try to find out who your local health department is and visit their website. If you have questions, you can get a lot of answers there. Also, the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, they have a lot of guidance and a lot of helpful information on their website as well to help get you a little bit more knowledge. Other trusted sources might be colleges and universities that do research on these types of diseases. They have a lot of really great information on their sites as well. I would recommend those too.
So you joining the show and educating us today is wonderful, and we're extremely grateful.
Thank you for watching. We hope you watch again, and next time we'll have further discussion on the vaccine and vaccinations for COVID-19. So make sure you follow Deaf and Hard of Hearing Services on Facebook and subscribe to us. You also have YouTube available to check our resources and to find out about our future shows.
And if you would like to donate and support this show, you can check out our website, which is deafhhs.org/donate. If you have any suggestions for future topics or any questions, health questions that you would like to know more information about, then please email us at hands-on-health@deafhhs.org. Thank you.
Thank you.